Welcome, everybody. Thank you so much for joining us here tonight in an unlikely story. I'm so happy to see such a great crowd here for Stuart in his writing workshop. We couldn't offer all these amazing authors without your support, so again, we're very grateful to see you here. I've known Stuart for a lot of years through events at Wellesley, as well as other places, and I'm thrilled to welcome him here in an unlikely story. Stuart is the founder and principal of Book Architecture. He spent over 15 years helping writers become authors, signing with top literary agencies, sealing deals with coveted publishing houses, and forging a successful path through indie publishing. Their clients have reached the New York Times bestseller lists in both fiction and nonfiction, and have appeared on Oprah, The Today Show, The Tonight Show, and in the most prestigious journals in their respective fields. So, knows what he's doing. His approach combines theories of narrative structure, and along with his hands-on experience as an independent editor, book coach, and ghostwriter. Stuart's also an award-winning essayist and poet who has toured the Book Architecture Method through over 70 venues in North America, and he also teaches writing at Grub Street of Boston and Brown University. We're thrilled to welcome him here to Plainville this evening, where he will share his great insights and knowledge with you. So without further ado, please give a warm welcome to Stuart Horowitz.
Can you hear me? Yeah, okay. So thank you, Kim and Deb, who had to leave, but she's the general manager and she's awesome also. And Kristen Stevin, who first turned me on to this bookstore many years ago, or not many years ago, because it's only been open for 18 months. And Jeff, by extension, for having this awesome bookstore. So I think the plan tonight is that the presentation's about an hour, then we can do questions after that. An hour is kind of a strange time. Like, I had to decide how much to hold back, and I just said, you know what, let's not hold back anything. So it's going to come at you kind of fast and furious, okay? So apologies for that. It'll all make sense. There are some short films that are made with action figures, and the individual who created those and was a huge inspiration on the project in general, Dave Stevin, is here. You might be wondering why we're watching these short films, and then you might say, well, there's too much information, where are the short films again? You know, so it's just, it'll alternate. I do want to say that I'm passing around a clipboard here, which is for a raffle. So if you give me your email address, you'll be entered to win this raffle. The raffle is not something cheesy, okay? It is a complete set of my three books on writing. The trilogy, never offered before, is a raffle prize. So. Plus, we send out an email like once every 8 months, so your buy-in is low. Thank you also to anybody who buys one of the books so I don't have to go back to being a wedding planner. All right, so we're here today to talk about the drafting process. We have the title of my most recent book is Finish Your Book in Three Drafts, but before we get to that, I think we want to talk about the fact that drafting occurs in every media. It certainly occurs in songwriting. You probably know this song. Even if you didn't hear this version. So this is just John getting the idea. In India, he's got some chords. But he got some help, which is something they do during the creative process, right? Like from Ringo. And this is clearly better, but it didn't start out this way. So even though they're geniuses, it's still a problem. Sarcastic background vocals. the White Album? I'm just kidding. So, you know, it's funny because we all get bad reviews at times, and I was somewhere and seeing that somebody on Amazon had given the White Album 1 star, and I was like, okay, all right. I just feel a lot better now. Who, how, why? Okay. So this is my third book on writing, which is the one that, you know, we're talking about tonight chiefly. Finish Your Book in 3 Drafts. How to Write a Book, Revise a Book, and Complete a Book While You Still Love It. The why you still love it is important enough that our graphic designer Molly put it in a different color. That's really what we're trying to achieve here, in addition to getting to the finish line. So if you've ever asked yourself while writing, how many drafts is this going to take? It might seem like such a question doesn't have an answer. But I would propose that it does, and that the answer is 3, provided that we approach each draft with the right spirit and take the right actions between drafts. So just as important as the drafts are what we're going to be doing in between. So 3 drafts. 3 drafts, not 1 draft. This is Jack Kerouac's scroll for On the Road. You might be familiar with this. There's sort of this literary myth that he wrote On the Road in 1 benzedrine and marijuana-fueled 21-day period. Some parts of this are true. He did tape together pieces of typewriter paper so it wouldn't have to change the roll. The drugs are probably true. You know, you can see on here, can you see that little red dot back there? Okay, good. Everything's working today, Kim. Every single piece of AV is working. So, you know, these are all the changes, the crossouts, the things written in. So this is, in effect, is his second draft. And then when it was typeset for Viking, he made a whole bunch of other changes. So that basically is 3 drafts. 3 drafts, not 49 drafts. Anybody?
Oscar.
Yeah, Oscar Wilde. Good. Hope you win the raffle. Just for knowing that. So you may have heard this cute story about Oscar Wilde. A woman who was his host on a writing retreat, hostess, asked him how his work was going. And he answered her, "I have spent most of the day putting in a comma, and the rest of the day taking it out." You know, okay, that doesn't count as a draft, right? That's not what we're trying to accomplish here. That's called tinkering with your book as opposed to tackling it, which is really what we're going to try to talk about here. Because you can easily spend your whole life writing the same book, but I don't recommend it. Okay. Throughout the 3 drafts here, we'll talk about some mantras for each draft, things to keep in mind. Here's one overall one, which is to know what draft you're in. So it's pretty easy when you start out to know that you're in the first draft, but you know, it gets a little more challenging when you're in the 3rd draft and you've discovered a hole or some missing material, and now you have to approach that missing material with 1st draft rules, right? In a 1st draft spirit. Otherwise, you'll be staring at it like, why aren't you as good as your brothers and sisters, and, you know, they'll rebel. We know about kids. Some of them may be in this room right now. Each draft has different rules, as I mentioned. I normally recommend that for the 1st draft, we pants. So if you're not familiar with that, pantsing is, it's really like writing by the seat of your pants. Right? And our pantser is represented here by Biz on the left. So Biz is someone who, you know, she just likes to see where the day is gonna take her. She loves to write. She hates to revise. Anything that looks like an outline, looks like math, looks like work, looks like school, looks like not interested, I follow the muse. Okay, so if you're like nodding along, you're probably a little more of a pantser. The outliner is symbolized by Roshi over here. The outliner is somebody who meticulously crafts the writing sessions instead. Hi, Stephanie. Somebody who really likes to know what the plan is and then execute it. And doesn't really like the incursions of new things. So if you, that's more you, you probably know that's more you. I do think that even though you hear this at writing conferences, you know, and things like that, that this is a bit of a false distinction, that we're all both of these. And that's what we really need, access to both sides of our psyche. Okay, we need to be able to pants, pantsing's called for, and outline when outline is called for. Let's check in on Biz, who is our prototypical pantser. And I think this will be loud enough, but.
I always dreamed of being a writer. I wrote most of my book in 5 months. It just flowed. I don't know. I couldn't wait to get home and work on it. Writing is so much fun. But I never knew how much work it would be. And then I had no idea what to do. I moved some paragraphs around. I tried to put the middle at the beginning to make it more interesting. It stopped being fun. It was exhausting. When I got home from work, I had better things to do.
Okay, so I know what you're thinking, or maybe what some of you are thinking, which is I don't even have that much material. Like, you know, Biz has got a whole sheaf of papers that explode when she hits the Jersey barrier of writer's block. So let's back up and talk about how she got that. Draft one is the messy draft, is that another way of calling it? How to generate material. So everybody has their own favorite tricks and tips for how to generate material. These are my 6 favorite. And the first is to count your words, which seems pretty anal. I know, but I do it every session regardless. The computer makes it easy, right? You highlight it, you can see your word count right there. But I count my words even if I write longhand, which I still do. Does anybody here ever like switch up the medium that they're working on? I think it can unstick you, especially for the first draft. I just wrote something on my phone, which was a little labor intensive, and then I sent it to someone. And they were like, what's this? I'm like, never mind. That's a first draft of something. But, you know, it changes your eye level. But back to counting. So why do we count? Well, we count because you can't simultaneously know the value of what you're creating and create at the same time. Okay, it's like looking in 2 directions at once. And your affective experience while writing is often wrong. You may have had this experience. You sit down and you're like, I am killing it today. I am just laying it out. And then you look back tomorrow and you're like, it's all right. You know? And the other times where it's just, you know, it feels like you're just moving in concrete blocks and then later you don't change your word. So we're not going to go with how we feel. We're going to go with word count. And then we can get into how many words you want to write per session, per week, per month. I think having a monthly goal is a really good idea. I usually recommend 10,000 words a month, which we call the 10K challenge around the office. Just kind of cheesy, but you know, has anybody ever done NaNoWriMo, which is, right, it's the National Novel Writers Month, where they have you write 50,000 words in a month, which is crazy. So I run a firm of independent editors, and the phone rings a lot on December 1st and 2nd. They're like, I wrote 50,000 words in a month. What do I do? Well, okay, we'll figure it out. Anyway, so to get there first, you need to count your words. I do just want to point out this. I wrote the first draft of the book we're talking about on my great uncle's typewriter from 1963, which he had in mint condition because he worked for the New York Times and he was very detail-oriented. And, you know, this is... It really allowed me to express my thoughts without fear because, you know, I was able to sort of put XXXXX through things that weren't working and draw arrows and write in the margins. You know, no one's going to see this, okay? So that's the first tip. The second tip is to find a neutral audience. So I don't know about you, but a lot of times when I write, I find myself, like, in my mind, I'm trying to avoid the critics, right? Those people who bring harsh or careless energy. And I try to seek out the cheerleaders, those people who I know have my back, right? But that doesn't really get it in the end. That's sort of two sides of the same tortured psychic coin, okay? It's better to find a neutral audience to write to. This is Roshi. You can see Roshi's life size right there, okay? So critics say, well, you know, you're working in a pretty crowded field. Or why are we gonna listen to them? Did Jeff Kinney listen to them? No. What's more crowded than the children's book industry? You know, and your cheerleaders are like, I've never heard anything like your story before, right? But the neutral audience just says, if it's nonfiction, what do I need to know about this? Or if it's fiction, what happens next? So it's sort of the corollary to, if you don't know if what you're writing is of any value, why not write to somebody else who doesn't know either? So then there's the question of where you would find such a person. You may be in a writing group. You can
hire an independent editor.
That's my only plug. Okay, maybe that's my second one so far. I'm on that. You know, or you can involve beta readers, which we're going to talk about between the second and the third draft. And there's a lot of good information there, hopefully, for you. And finally, you can involve your friends and family, provided you read them the Riot Act first. So, like, when I teach a class, there's two things you can't say. You can't say, I love it, and you can't say, well, I guess I'm just not your audience. It's just code for I hate it, right? You have to try to be a neutral audience. All right. Our third trick here is don't try to organize anything. So this drives the people crazy. Yes, somebody's saying, oh.
Yeah.
An outliner here in the front row is like, wait a second. I don't know about that. So sometimes people come to me with these complex outlines before they've ever written a word. And I kind of have to tell them that that's not really the way it works. It could work that way if you were writing creative nonfiction about events that have already happened. So you sort of already have your plot points. But for the most part, I think it's like E.M. Forster says, how can I know what I think until I see what I say? Okay? Meaning, things have to get messy. Messy draft. So people say, well, if I don't organize anything, I might repeat myself. And I'm going to tell you that repeating yourself in the first draft is good. There's absolutely no reason why you shouldn't write the same scene three times in the first draft. In fact, if you do that, you're trying to tell yourself it's important. The question is whether or not you have a method, not necessarily my method or anybody else's method, but your own method of finding those three places, weaving them together into one uber scene that really kicks it. That's the challenge. It's not saying I already wrote this scene once. Okay. Number four is make the time, which seems kind of silly because, you know, we've all made the time, right? So this is for the other people who signed up and aren't here. I don't know, is there anybody like that? Okay, you know, I mean, later we can talk about bills and kids and out-of-town guests and day jobs and aging parents and commutes and chores, right? But we make time for all those things. So the question is, why don't we make time for this? This is Biz going to a coffee shop in a universe parallel to Portland, Oregon. And so she's going to make the time, which means she's going to park her car, realize she doesn't have quarters, go in the bank, get the quarters, feed the meter, go in, order her one pump vanilla, one pump mocha, latte for the win. Biz is based on a real person, and that's her coffee order. We have a very non-hierarchical office where I could just as easily be the person who does that coffee order. So. Anyway, and then sit down and do her 2 hours from there, because that is how she is authorizing herself, which we can see comes from the same root as the word author, right? No one is going to authorize you to spend your time writing except you. So, you know, and the truth is that people would rather hear almost anything else, right? I'm going to go write, oh, are you published? Okay, yes, no, what difference does it make, right? You know, they don't necessarily want, they would really rather hear anything else. They'd rather hear, I'm going to sew the kids' Halloween costumes. Oh, great. You know, I'm going back to church for the second time today. That sounds great, you know. I'm going out on the boat. Great. I'm going to go write. It's like, I think that they're afraid that they're in your book. And this is one of my clients who's a thriller writer, Larry Erickson, also going to this coffee shop in, I guess, a universe parallel to Biz. Anyway, so the question comes up, so I'm counting my words and I'm making the time. Now, am I counting my hours? And the answer is no. There's a certain, get past diminishing returns. Once you make the time, you'll find that your flow of words takes its own pace if your ego doesn't interfere, which obviously is easier said than done. But that's what we're trying to do, is we're trying to listen. This is our fifth tip. Did you get your sign in the background? So what are we listening for? Well, Saul Bellow called the flow of words in our ear the prompter. And the prompter, he said we all have one too. So if you're starting to tune out, being like, well, I'm not Saul Bellow. We all have one. And that's what brings us the flow of words. And that is also what we talk about when we say voice, right? This is what we're listening for. We're listening for the sound of our own voice. And somebody said that they thought we photoshopped her in there, but we didn't. We took her out to the cliff. And we had that. Okay. So one of my clients is an energy healer who told me that only 2% of what we think comes from our authentic selves. And I did not ask her how she came up with that statistic. But it's like, for the rest of it, it's like a pinball of thought was set off in our minds by our family or our culture, and now it's just binging and clinging off every conceivable surface. And that's why we can't listen. Or I should say, that's why we can't hear. So we have to get rid of those horrible pinball noises through meditation, exercise, adult beverages. We have to have fun.
Can you repeat what you said, 2%?
I'm sorry?
The sentence you began with, what was it, 2% of?
2% of what we think comes from our authentic selves. So that's the 2% we're trying to get. I think it's probably more than that. But one of the ways you know that you're channeling your authentic self is because you're having fun. This is me having fun. This was a crazy idea that worked out. It was fun. You know, this is Dave Stevin, who created the videos. This is him having fun. And somebody said, well, you shouldn't really show the behind-the-scenes stuff. But I think the point is that everything is made, right? And if you can capture some of the freshness of your joy of discovery in the final product, then the reader will experience that too. So this is the white ox who Biz is about to meet. I do just want to say one other thing about fun, though. We're not talking about stupid fun, right? We're talking about intellectual aliveness. We're talking about the joy of discovery. We're talking about pantsing at its finest, is when you're rewarded with something you didn't know you were able to come up with. Okay? All right, so let's go back to Biz is about to meet the white ox, but first let's remind ourselves where we last left her. And then this happens.
Am I, supposed to ask you something?
You see the method.
Oh, great. A talking ox.
It's fun, right? We're having fun. So I'm actually not sure how this kind of thing happens. You know, you get involved with other people, collaboration takes you in directions you don't expect. And speaking of directions, the white ox seems to be pointing in a direction. But where are we going? I stole this off of Biz's Facebook page. Towards a metaphorical mountain of organization and revision, perhaps? Let's find out.
I should have stayed in Brooklyn. Of course, the white ox doesn't like to stop and wait for Biz. Twitter isn't even working. Can't I get airlifted in a helicopter? So this is the part where somebody tells me it's about the journey and not the destination, right?
Okay, so that's Roshi, who we met earlier. And that's the cave where he lives. And that's called the Willing Suspension of Disbelief. You are familiar with that quote by Samuel Coleridge. But at this point, Biz's disbelief isn't all that willing.
My book is a mess.
There is a method.
What if I'm left out? How do I end it? Where are all these subplots going? What am I even writing about? Should I stop?
Look to the ancient art of revision.
But my MFA teacher says
there is a method.
But my mom says
there is a method.
You don't know anything about my book. What are you pushing? Some kind of formula?
Your ears do not hear. This is a method, not a formula.
The ancient art of revision? Chill, Mr. Miyagi. This is not the Karate Kid. You can't write a good book without a method.
We have to give the credit for this to Cooper Stevin, who maybe was 8 at the time, the filmmaker's son, came down and he was like watching the action figures. He's like, well, they have to fight, right? And we're like, right, let's have fun. That would be fun. So, you know, their dynamic is changing a little bit here, and Roshi has increased respect for Biz, and Biz becomes willing to listen, at least for a little while.
The first draft is the easy part. The book architecture method is a 22-step process for organizing and revising your manuscripts. It is how best-selling authors get from first draft to final draft. 22 may seem like a big number. Really, the number you need to know is 3. Scene, series, and theme.
So scene, series, and theme are the building blocks of the book architecture method, which we don't have time to go into, but they are in the books. And yes, the book architecture method has 22 action steps, which may seem like a lot, but it used to be 81. Until my literary agent talks some sense to me. So I always say if people complain too much, I'm just going to go back and put the 81 back in there. But, you know, for our purposes, where are we? Is the first draft the easy part, as Roshi says? Not really. I mean, maybe it's easy because it's done by this point. But it is easy if we remember to keep it moving. Okay? So first draft, we're writing quickly and not looking back. This is Lot's wife from Genesis 19. You may recall the story where she was not supposed to look back at Sodom and Gomorrah while they were burning, or she would turn into a pillar of salt. Okay. I'm not going to comment on the veracity of this story here, but it does remind me of writers who heavily edit today what they wrote yesterday. Like, let's keep those eyes front, right? What is there to see back there? Like what you screwed up, it's still going to be there, okay? And I mean, the bottom line is that you are going to have questions, and some people don't like to have questions without answers. But that doesn't mean that the answers are going to come just because you want them to. German poet Rilke said, "Live the questions now," which I think is good. Like if you have 5 major questions at the end of the first draft, by going through this process or your own process, you know, 3 of them may resolve themselves naturally over time. The 4th one, you might be able to ask your beta readers. And the 5th one, you may never get an answer to. And you make it up as best you can. But that's the nature of the creative process. So now we're between the first draft and the second draft, where instead of just writing and rewriting, which turns into tinkering, right? I don't really know what I'm doing. I'm just going to look at chapter 13 today. We want to find a way to step back and analyze our work between drafts. So when I talk about the book architecture method, I'm talking about a method that works for me that I would invite you to look into, and maybe all the steps work, maybe some of them work, maybe none of them work. What I'm really trying to tell you is you should have a method. Everybody everybody should have a method for being able to look at their work between drafts. And that allows you to ask important reorienting questions. Okay, so like we like to say around the office, intelligent planning is not the enemy of creative genius. We don't actually say that, but we did put it on the wall. So it can remind us. I'm just gonna point out my first two books here just so you have a sense of what they do, not as some kind of gross sales pitch. This light blue book is if you have 60 to 100 pages or more, and it is the 22 action steps for revision. The colorful book contains some of the tools that we're gonna talk about, the arc, the grid, and the target, that help you outline the material you've pantsed in a way that you can, you know, move forward. I mention these not, you know, again, to sell books, but because we're only gonna talk about a couple action steps right now. So I don't want you to think like if you just do these three things, you're all set, okay. But you know, it will help. One of them, the first one that I really like to talk about is to brainstorm all of your scenes. So what you wanna do here, you're making me nervous. I feel like I'm in an Italian restaurant or something. I don't have my back to the wall. How do you brainstorm your scenes? You give each scene a name, you know, something that brings you back there in your mind. And, you know, then you just try to remember every scene you can. But the catch is that you can't look at the book itself. All right, in case you were taking notes, we'll watch that one more time. Nope. All right, so why is she left in her cave by herself? The answer is because your memory is the surest guide to the memorable. And people say, I'll remember every scene in my book, but they never can. In 15 years, I've had one student who could remember every single scene in their book, and he was blind, which I know means something, but I'm not really qualified to say why. So when you have a list of your scenes, you know, then you go back to the manuscript and you see the ones you forgot. And if you forgot it, that's not necessarily strike three, but it could be strike one. Could be a way to get some information. This works with blogs too, for that matter. I was recently writing a blog, and I knew I had 7 points that I wanted to make, but I didn't have the list with me, so I was like, oh, let's do the action step of brainstorming the points. And I remembered 5 of them. And then I went to the office and found the list. And the 6th one, you know, was a decent idea. The 7th one was one I never liked. And I've just been dragging it around because I thought of it once. So now it has to be in every version of everything I ever write, you know. So this is action steps allowing you to free yourself from the material. When you have all of your scenes listed, both from memory and then from the book itself, then comes the fun part. We cut them up.
You want me to what?
I want you to find the places where the scenes break, and I want you to cut your manuscript into all of its independent scenes.
First of all, I use Scrivener for that. I'm not in kindergarten. What next? Glue sticks and glitter?
Actually, I use a stapler. When you use the computer, it's too easy to say I'm having an off day and just revert to an older version of your manuscript. I recommend at least once per project, cut it up.
Ah, what are you doing?
You know, bless the tree that wants to become a book. What's that saying?
Every tree aspires to become a book. Give me that. You don't even know what you're doing.
And then we can see which scenes are meaty and which scenes you've just been dragging around draft to draft that really belong in this file.
That is absolutely terrifying. What if, like, the best line ever written by a human being ends up stuck under that pile?
We have to see the forest for the trees.
The same trees we cut down to make all these books?
We have to move on.
But does it have to be this complicated?
If the way presented to you seems easy, it is probably false.
But what if scene one is still scene one? And scenes 2 and 3 are still scenes 2 and 3.
And what if scene 4 is actually scene 17? We break your manuscript down to the level of unit, because unit plus unit plus unit equals unity. And that way we can take the best parts up a level.
But how did you do that? How do you know that's the right order? How do you know which the best parts are?
So that is the work of the second draft, is to take the best parts up a level. Now, even though we're saving questions to the end, sometimes this is where somebody's like, wait, do you seriously print the manuscript out and cut it up? And so I wanted to show you some real pictures. Here's Liz having cut it up. There's her scissors. There's her stapler. There's her scenes, which have paper clips. These are the meatier scenes. And these are the scraps of paper she's been dragging around draft to draft that really belong in this pile, the detritus pile. And then your outline can emerge. So this is Wendy's scene list here. These are her scene names. And now she's starting to shuffle around her scenes. And this is a more extended outline that she's creating. But this outline is based on what she's already done, rather than those complex outlines before she's ever written a word. So cutting up our scenes is how we get new ideas or glimpse the connections between things. And eventually it looks like this, right? So this is Sandra's, she's getting ready to write her second draft here. Each of these is a scene. A scene is not the same thing as a chapter, right? So these first three scenes are part of chapter one. There's a little bit more table there. And these post-it notes are information for how she wanted to rewrite when she got set to rewrite. And I guess as an aside, Kim mentioned Grub Street of Boston, which is a great place to take writing classes. And this was their old Grub Street, where I used to teach. And when we came in to put this all together, Sandra was writing a memoir about her sister who died of cancer. And when we came into this room, there was nothing here at all except this one book that said Margie on it, which was her sister's name. We were like, wow, okay. It's not Margie. I guess we're going to be okay here. Does this go here? Does this go here? So this looks great, right? We're ready to do this. Now, it isn't, there are other tools that you can use to get here. It isn't just like you just know where all the scenes go. But like I said, we're not going to have a chance to go through all the tools. You can make a series, you can make a grid. This is J.K. Rowling's grid for book 5 of Harry Potter. And a grid is an outline, but it's more spatial in nature. So what you're looking at here are, these are the chapter numbers, and these are the chapters of the rows, okay? And what's coming down here are the different narrative through lines, what I call series, that exist within the book. So this gives you a sense of sort of everything that can happen within a given chapter, and allows you to be a little more holistic, rather than a linear list. This is Joseph Heller's grid for Catch-22, which is crazy. It's actually kind of that size. I went to see it at Brandeis in their rare book room, and it was me and the rare book librarian, and then, like, she wasn't leaving, so it was like us. And I was like, I guess she's afraid I'm gonna erase something from that. It's written in pencil, you know? I do think that the fact that it's written in pencil is interesting. Like, these are tools that famous authors and stuff use to get from one place to another. Whether they save it at the end or not, that's up to you. So that's the grid. We can chart our narrative arcs so that we can get them to interact and intersect and come together in an emotional payoff. And we can put our theme in the bullseye of the target. So that was the grid, the arc, and the theme. We're just flying through these. The theme, we put that in the bullseye of the target, and then put our characters, our scenes, our events on the target, closer to or further from the theme, based on its relevance. So let's stop there for a second and talk about theme, which is a good thing to find during your second draft. So as far as theme goes, I believe that your book can only be about one thing. Okay, and we call that your theme. Thank you for nodding. I appreciate that. Sometimes people will be like, what about two things? Can my book be about two things? I just got that from a 17-year-old. And I'm like, yes, provided those two things are about one thing, right? I'm like, 47, you're 17. You really want to square off here? had another student who said, your book can only be about one thing. You say that a lot. I'll bet that's your one thing. Okay. So there are several ways of figuring out what your theme is, and one is to write down, you know, what you thought you were writing about. Another is to figure out how what you thought you were writing about has now changed. And hopefully it has, because the act of writing a draft, you know, concepts change as we complete them. So, you know, it should be different. There are also ways of, you know, arranging all your narrative through lines and taking the top four and writing an elevator pitch and boiling that down. There's also finding it right in the middle of your book. So when you have your theme, I'll give you a couple examples of theme just so we can proceed from that. So I found myself and my man found me. This is kind of the standard theme of all chick lit, right? This actually came from a client I was working with. Okay. It's not how you fall in life, it's how you pick yourself up, which might sound like a cliche to you. It probably is a cliche. But I think the question is whether or not you believe it. Like, do you believe this? Do you believe that? Yeah, I do too, right? And then the originality, you know, the thing about a theme is it does not have to be original. It just has to be something you believe. But the originality is the clothing that you put on it, like how a girl goes from being a drunk, crying lesbian to just being a drunk lesbian. You can see the change in that, right? She might be all set now. That's Jen at Boston University contributed that. So here's a theme that's 28 words long, which is long. To the outside world, the Navy may appear to be black and white. To the officers and men that served, the Navy was 1,000 shades of gray. Your theme has to be two words, at least, a subject and a verb, right? I was working with an author who said, my theme is conformity. And it wasn't quite enough to give everything direction. But then we started, you know, digging deeper, and it was a book about, you know, three generations of Germans. Well, there was obviously the Nazi generation and what conformity meant then. Then there was the 60s generation and how they rebelled against everything that the Nazis represented. And then there was the generation that came of age in the 80s who had to somehow make sense of both of these different kinds of people. And she said, oh, I know what it is. It's conformity corrodes. We're like, right, there you go. Now you've got a theme that you can work with. So two words is the shortest. 28 words is a lot to remember when you are matching every scene against, now does this represent this? So Rich shortened this to 1,000 Shades of Gray, which then became his title, which was before 50 Shades of Gray. So you can get your tee-hees out now. And if you ever meet Rich, like, don't bring it up. Because he's a big Navy dude and he just doesn't want to talk about it. All right, so earlier I showed you the theme target, and this is Rich's target when we did it in class. So it says 1,000 Shades of Gray right in the center. You know, and then you can put your material on there based on how much it represents that. Like homosexuality in the Navy was perfect. Total shade of gray there. The Soviets, this was a good scene where one sub rescues another sub from freezing cold waters. But it's at the height of the Cold War, and it's a Russian sub that rescues a US sub. So the shade of gray is like the allegiance they feel towards each other as submariners is stronger than the contrived political differences of the Cold War. So everything that makes the target can make the next draft, and things that don't make the target might be your darlings. Some of you may be familiar with this quote by William Faulkner, kill all your darlings. To me, the darlings are the things that, like, in Rich's target, there was like 150 pages of gambling, drinking, and womanizing that didn't make this piece of paper at all. And, you know, they may have been fun for him to write. They may have been fun to live and then to write about. But, you know, we were only able to get about 25 pages in this book. And the shade of gray was, well, they're carefree young men away from home for the first time, but they're also serious scientists. Okay, little shade of gray, we got 25 pages in. But for the rest of it, it was like a novella was lurking inside his novel, like inside a Trojan horse. It has to get cut out. Right, because now we're into the second draft, which is about you know, turning things over. And this is Jeanette's target. She's taking the extra courage here to tag the things that don't make the target with these heavy green stickies so they don't convince her that they actually belong. Things that you've already written can get very, they have a hypnotic quality, right? You're like, well, I already did that, and it came to me, so it must be good, or I must need it, or it must be part of this book. And that's really what we want to try to cut off at the root. Now, you know, whether things are right in the center or outliers, tangents, these are some of the fine points which we can get into. But basically, if it's on the target, you can keep it because not everything needs to change. There's a mantra for the second draft. Remember, we're taking the best parts up a level. And so the number one job in the second draft is to preserve and augment the best of what is there. So, like I was saying at the beginning, if you uncover things you need that you don't have, you have to remember to write those with first draft attitude. Have fun, listen, count your words, right? And not enforce these rules. Okay, let's check in on Biz and Roshi and see what they've been up to.
Don't you want to know what it is? Oh, I get it. This is like a Zen thing. I keep it to myself, and it grows in power. So now what? If the first draft is the easy part, the second draft is what? The hard part?
Actually, the hard part is querying agents.
Okay. We're going to talk about querying agents in a little bit. We're not quite ready for that. The second draft isn't necessarily the hard part, if you can remember to just do what you can do at any given time. So right now you're just trying to make it better. This is one of my favorite things to put in the margin of someone's work when I'm editing it. Make this better. Or sometimes halfway through I get tired of just writing, make better. You know, I don't know exactly how, but this clearly needs to be better. So that kind of takes some of the pressure off, right? Like, what would make this better? All right, let's fast forward in the interest of time to assuming that the second draft is done. See how fast this is going? I mean, we're going to write a book in an hour here. And then between the second and third draft, we're going to bring in the beta reader. So what is a beta reader? A beta reader is an individual who reads your work before it is finished and offers you feedback. Now, not just any feedback, constructive, motivating, and eye-opening. To help you prepare for your third and final draft that we call the polished draft. Well, that's the way it's supposed to work anyway, okay? There are obstacles, and one of them is nobody is objective, right? Somebody says, I'm gonna be objective, run for the hills. What we're really looking for is people who are gonna offer transparently subjective feedback. Okay, so it's like, how conscious can a beta reader be? And here we might borrow some strategies from therapy. Anybody? Just me. Okay. Can your beta reader make I statements? You know, can they say, when I read X, it made me think of Y. And that is why I think it might be a little too Z. You don't have to agree with me, but that's where I'm coming from. So this is the kind of feedback that you can then check for your own resonance. And so you don't want them to try to be objective. You do want them to be neutral, symbolized here by Roshi's blank book face. Right? Neutrality has no agenda. And the opposite of having no agenda can be seen in this, the weirdest video that we ever made.
Going on? Why doesn't anyone want to sit next to me?
I've got a monster headache. Roshi? Is that you? There's an awful lot of men on this train, don't you think?
Well, you've read her book. Doesn't it make sense? What do you expect from someone who practically lives off shock value?
Who are you guys? You've read my book? Why do I look like this?
You're a rhino now, honey. It's natural to feel a little alienated, but don't worry about that. Look at the big picture. You wrote a book. Not everybody writes a book.
These days they do. Do you have any idea how many people self-published a book last year?
Stop. You're scaring her. We're not even at that point in the process yet.
All I'm saying is, don't quit your day job.
I think you're a brave soul. Your work makes me want to weep, in a good way.
Oh, boy. Again with the weeping. Come on. This is our stop.
Is it my stop, too?
Not yet. You just keep up the good work, honey. You'll know when it's time.
Roshi? Is that you? There were two androids, a husband and a wife, I think. They looked exactly alike, but had different ideas. One of them thought everything I did was great. I liked her more. Were those my beta readers?
No, that was the critic and the cheerleader. They're hard to avoid. Your beta readers are something completely different. And unlike those two, beta readers can actually be helpful.
This is the first time you ever have the cheerleading and the critical android both in the same room at the same time at one of these events, so that makes me feel good. So how many beta readers should I have is the next question. And it's more than two, and it's not these two, okay? But no, there's a real answer to that. So I propose that the number of beta readers be between 3 and 7, okay? If you have less than 3, you might weight the individual feedback too strongly. And if you have more than 7, you might feel like the air traffic control is getting out of hand. It isn't like the more beta readers, the better, because this is not a democracy, right? We're not taking votes, right? We're looking for resonance. Sometimes consensus can help you, but for the most part, you also maybe you might want to go a little bit over 7 because sometimes people aren't going to do the assignment that we give them, which is a beta reader questionnaire. My first book gathered a group of 7 people, and one of them didn't do the assignment. She wrote me a 3-page letter, which had an idea that was so good I had to write a whole other chapter. And I was like, all right, I forgive you for not doing the assignment. Then I had another person who was like, No! I need more here. No! And I was like, all right, don't have an ego, right? I mean, you asked for this. No! So finally, I just took her and I threw it out. I'm like, I'm not getting anything out of this besides upset and afraid. Okay? So now I have 6. So there's a reason to maybe go a little. That's a tale told out of school, okay? I'm going to rely on you. With beta readers, there has to be an equal energy exchange. Because we're going to ask them to do some work. So one of my friends wrote her entire master's thesis on the philosophy of giving and receiving. I'll break it down here for you. There has to be both. Okay. You want to make sure you're giving something of value in return to your beta readers so that you can ask something of substance from them. So maybe you're beta reading their books, or you're offering free PR or SEO advice, or you're dog sitting for them next week, or you're paying them. But you can't be unappreciative of your beta readers. So ask them how you can best return the favor. The beta reader questionnaire is the heart of the beta reader experience. So to enhance their neutrality, we want to ask them 10 specific questions. We want to suggest that they write a paragraph or two in response to each question. We want to set a reasonable date for reading your manuscript, based on the length of the work and the amount of time you've been on your calendar. And of course, you want to remind them that the work hasn't been copy edited yet. And you find people will ignore this all the time. They're like, I found a whole bunch of mistakes. And you're like, this is not at all what we're talking about, okay? Why would I fix the grammar of a chapter that I'm not even going to keep? Right? You got to see. So you got to look for people who can see past. Then we want to ask them. Here's an idea of the kinds of specific questions that we want to ask them. So content. You know, what scenes did you remember the best? Did you want less violence? Did you want more sex? Those kinds of content questions. Pacing. Which parts did you want to skip? Where did you feel there was an emotional payoff? Did the answers to your questions come later than you were looking for them? And you do want to choose beta readers who like your genre. That's important, right? I was working with a fiction writer who chose someone who only reads nonfiction. And her objection was, when I had a question, it wasn't answered right then. We were like, yeah, that's kind of how fiction works. Okay. Thanks, though. Okay, in marketing, you can ask them questions that might help with some of the nonfiction book proposal or query letter that you're going to have to write. Like, if you were to describe this book to someone in one paragraph, how would you do it? Who would you recommend this book to and why? What author's works did it remind you of? That kind of thing. So let's look at a sample questionnaire. This is Pat's beta reader questionnaire. I have to tell you a little bit about Pat to make this make sense. So Pat is a neuroscientist who became aware that through her work that midlife for human beings has greatly expanded. It used to be like the end of youth was the beginning of old age, and now there's this like 35-year period from 40 to 75, which is like the new midlife, right? And she became aware that there are no fairy tales that affect that phase of life. Has that ever been a problem for you? Well, anyway, it was a problem for Pat, so she set out to write some fairy tales to address the new midlife. That's what I think all we need to know. So some of the questions are pretty straightforward, right? Like number 7, which 3 tales were your least favorite and why? And every single person mentioned the one that I've been trying to get her to take out for 6 months, just sort of point that out. Which 3 tales spoke to you the most clearly and why? Again, it's not a democracy, but it is. You can get some consensus in it. People are starting to say the same thing. So you can derive something from consensus. But what you're really looking for is resonance. So for example, question 4, so because she's a neuroscientist, she divided her tales into 4 groups. And then she introduced each group with a 10-page introduction on like the neuroscience. And then the question was, did you want more or less science in these introductions? And one person was like, more science and footnotes and suggestions for further reading. And another reader was just as emphatic, boo, no science. I almost put the book down because of the science. And it feels like maybe there's like a hung jury there, like she didn't learn anything. But she did learn something because she had that like yucky but still somehow uplifting feeling of what she had to do. It just removed the science. So when people give you bad news, it's not necessarily bad news, right? It's actually good news. And those are that was one of her darlings that had to be killed. But at the end of the day, you're in charge. That is the most difficult thing, but as we remembered back with Make the Time, author and authorizing, you're still the author. So I remember, I just actually found some notes from the beta read of my first book, and I had it, right? So I scrawled in the margin. Everybody wants me to sound like more of an authority, unless it's in places where they don't agree with me, and then they want me to be more open-ended, right? And so this is your life as a writer. And you just have to remember that you're in charge, which is a good lead into the third draft, where we are going to hit it and get out. Okay. So by way of recap, the first draft, or the messy draft, is all about getting it down. The second draft, or method draft, is all about making sense. And the third draft, the polished draft, is all about making it good. So some things to keep in mind during the third draft. One thing is to keep the publication wolves at bay, right? So like when Biz says, or Roshi says, the hard part is querying agents, we all know this is waiting for us, right? This is a from the 1974 film Steppenwolf, where there's a 7-minute cartoon called Track Data on Steppenwolf, which inspired these videos in my mind, even though they didn't end up like that, just as an aside. So keeping the publication wolves at bay. So at this point, you're going to be prone to daydreams about acceptance, or the converse, anxiety attacks about rejection. But neither of these are really going to help get us across the finish line at this point. It's not like you haven't been responsible. We've done some test marketing with beta readers, so we have some sense with what the chords are striking with them. But right now, you need to finish this draft on its own terms. And speaking of finishing, I like to talk about why some people don't finish, which is kind of a heavy topic, but since it's related to what we just discussed, I think I'll bring it up now. So there are a lot of reasons why people don't finish. And one is because they don't have a structured process to know what they need to be working on when, which hopefully this evening has helped with a little bit. And that's a pretty innocent way of getting lost anyway. Some people don't finish because they can't keep the publication wolves at bay, right? The pressure from the outside world gets too intense. And sometimes people can't bring themselves to put themselves out there as the author of this book. So they may have what are called hidden related commitments, where something just as strong or stronger is working against them being a successful publisher author. So whether you want to get really deep about it or just say, I can't seem to find the time, you know? One thing I want to say that will seem pretty obvious is that the people who quit can't make it. I'm a big fan of Venn diagrams. So recently I put one that was like songs that should not be covered was the big circle, and songs that Sarah McLachlan had covered goes in that, right? Sorry if you like Sarah McLachlan. But the idea being that the entire subset of people who, within the entire subset of people who didn't make it, everybody who quits is contained in that. If you quit, you can't make it. So, you know, finishing requires tenacity. And taking something all the way to the end does look kind of insane. But that's kind of you. Thank you. But of course, it won't feel insane. It will feel indescribably satisfying. Okay, so how do we do the third draft? I usually recommend putting together a punch list. This is a punch list for the last draft of my first book. Like, I wanted to tell the story of Lot. That was Lot's wife. What is there to see back there? Will we screw up? Will it still be there? I put that on the punch list. Then I highlighted it on the day that I was working on it, and then I crossed it off. Right? So, you know, what constitutes the punch list? It could be your beta reader responses that you agreed with. It could be the questions that you sort of had nagging at you all along. It could be the things from the notes that you've been keeping on the side. I don't know if you're like me, but I'm sort of an inveterate note keeper on the side. So this was like the folder of notes that I saved. Like, this is now your last chance, okay? So get in or get out, right? But the thing about the punch list, just going back to that for a second, is that you know, in the last draft, you don't have to go in order. In fact, I recommend that you don't. So the first draft, we sort of wrote in order because we didn't know what the order was, because we were just pantsing. And the second draft, I do think you start at the beginning and go all the way through. But now, you know your book well enough that you can just go to these items and hit it and get out. And that's a way, an action step, if you like, that you don't have to stare at page 28 and say, I know that you're supposed to be subtly better somehow. I don't know how, but I'm revising. So how can I make you better? Which, you know, is going to be difficult because it might not need to be any better. So one of the things, another third draft mantra here is to make decisions. Going back to, you know, Rilke, live the questions now. Let's say we had 5 major questions and 3 of them resolved themselves over the course of the process. One of them, you asked the beta readers. You said, I have not been able to figure this out. And it was one that was on your questionnaire. You got some good answers. So that's the answer. For the 5th question, you know, maybe you never got an answer. And so now you're left picking the least bad option of the things that you've tried, right? That's okay. I mean, there's no reader that perspicacious. Perspicacious, anybody? Okay. who's going to be like, I liked everything except for these things that you never figured out. You know, it'll be overwhelmed. Where you don't need it, where it doesn't need it, you won't get it. Right? So if you're looking at page 28 trying to figure out why I didn't nail this, it could be that it's done. Right? And you want to keep it moving. Because at this point, it is what it is. Right? And it's your job to appreciate that. And also to not screw it up. It's a very important thing to do in the third draft. A lot of times during the third draft, some of the decisions are about taking things out. And I do think that revision is about limitation. It could be characters, it could be scenes, it could be events. If you're writing nonfiction, it could be some of your more micro points that don't really lead anything except into a little cul-de-sac, or you know, some extremely long quotes that really just need to be the best part. And you have to trust the process, right? So the same process that said you got to bring the best parts up a level, you know, these are not the best parts. You don't need them, right? Or rather, you don't need them anymore. This is Hemingway's theory of the iceberg. Sorry about this slide, which is like the only iceberg slide out there. I was actually Googling iceberg slides. It's this one 85 different times. You would be amazed. I was actually going to do a study on all the different things that it was used for. But anyway, so thanks for laughing, Jim. I have a Jim flag. Okay, Hemingway's theory of the iceberg is that Hemingway thought that you should take out 7/8 of what you know about a subject and only leave the top 8 for the reader, which might mess with your word count. But it's the point is that readers know if you don't know the other 7/8. It's sort of like that top 8 is just an ice floe floating around ready to take out the Titanic or something. They know if it's not rooted. He also published the theory of omission and said that the value of a work is such that it can be judged by the quality of the material you took out. So, again, that may work with your word count. But I saw it recently. I was working on a 3,000-word personal essay, and I took it down to 1,700 words. And, you know, I read it about a month later. I couldn't actually remember what wasn't there anymore. So, in a sense, it's still there, right? Because it helped you get to these high points. So you can trust that. But you know, what I saw the other day with the 1,700 words was that everything that I wanted to say was there. So I always don't know, like, should I gesture more when I'm getting my picture taken? Should I be more personable? We're almost done, don't worry. The point is not to go through life writing the same book the whole time. When I said that earlier, so I know people who are doing that. You may know people who are doing this. You may be doing this. I have a friend who's a great poet, and lunch with him is a poem. Lunch with him is like 5 poems, right? But then he writes a new one, and he's got to take 3 out, or he's got to shuffle them around. And, you know, he's in his 60s, and we still don't have a book from him. I am terrified that I am his literary executor. And that we're looking at like an Emily Dickinson situation. Where I get like 1,000 poems, and now I have to close up shop for a year and work on this book. So, you know, we don't want to do that. It isn't just people like us who do this too, though. This is also famous people do this, right? This is Walt Whitman. He wrote Leaves of Grass when he was 37. In an epiphanic explosion of lyricism that, well, I can't even imagine what it would have been like to write that thing. You know, he contributed more words to the English language than anybody at that point since Shakespeare, right? So far so good, right? But then as an older man, he goes back and he's still revising it, and he's still screwing it up. And like, he called the shore slappy, slappy shore, and then he like took that word out because it's not a word. Okay, it's not a word, but it was great. And so, you know, there's another example where he said, looking in at the shop windows of Broadway the whole forenoon, flatting the flesh of my nose on the thick plate glass. Flatting the flesh, it's great, right? The later version, he changes that to pressing, No. Why? Put it down. Step away from the leaves of grass, please. You know, and actually, critics don't even use the old man version. Like, I just saw it put in the appendix. Like, if you want to see somebody screw up a work of art, check that out, right? It's the 37-year-old leaves of grass that they use. Because there is a crack in everything. That's how the light gets in. God rest your soul, wondered God, right? This is the Liberty Bell. I come from Philadelphia originally, where the Liberty Bell's on everything, right? Little League uniforms and soft pretzel wrappers. So we grow up thinking that, like, national icons are supposed to have something really wrong with them. But, you know, I mean, there are all kinds of ways of looking at this. There's the point of diminishing returns. There's the effort that it takes to get something from 96.8% done to 97.2% done. It's likely not worth it. There's the beauty of imperfection. There's something wrong in each of my books. You should still buy them. I'll give you an example. So in the first book, I was making the point about make the time, right? And what I said was that we're sort of rigorously set into the Industrial Revolution schedule, where we don't think about when we really like to write. We don't authorize ourselves. You know, maybe we like to write from 9 p.m. to 2 a.m. and then sleep for 4 hours, take your kids to school, go back to sleep, and then go to work. Like, we need to think beyond that. And I quoted Keith Richards, because you can't always quote Saul Bellow, who was supported by aversion to the Industrial Revolution schedule. And he said, so cooter is slang for nose. And he's like, well, when the cooter goes, you eat. Meaning, like, whenever you feel like eating, you should just eat. Like, live free, right? Live like me. No, don't do that. Anyway, so that's kind of a long setup. But then I got this email from a reader, Nancy, from Scotland, who said, hi, Stuart. Just started reading your Blueprint book and your annotation of the Keith Richard, sick quote, read our program eating habits jumped off, program eating habits jumped off the page at me. Indeed, cooter is slang for nose. If you're English, we Scots call it your neb. But I guess Keith didn't mean it in that sense. Uh-oh. He surely meant the cooter or siren, klaxon, whatever you want to call it, which was sounded in factories to denote breaks in the day, like lunchtime. Like, basically, you're completely wrong. So you just made that up. That's not at all what that's about. Looking forward to getting into the book anyway. All right, so what am I going to do? Am I going to go to Penguin and be like, can we change? No. It's fine. Okay? Because we have perfection on the one hand, and we have, as my mentor Jim Freeman in Prague used to say, that fresh feeling of not having been too well worked, which is of greater value than taking all the air out of something, nailing it down every place so that it's dry, you know, desiccated. Besides, it's time to move on and tackle the next writing project, right? Because we have all kinds of projects backed up. So let's check in on our people one more time here.
Do I have to leave? I mean, I want to leave. Is that wrong? I know I've already asked this, but can you come down the mountain with me?
I can come for a little bit.
I wonder what it's going to be like. Are people going to like my book? I know not everybody's going to like my book. But some people will, and I guess that's my audience, right? I was going to ask you if I could come visit again sometime, but you haven't been answering a lot of my questions. Like, what are you doing here right now?
I have to pick up my
drink. Well, can I come back? Could you still be a neutral audience?
You don't need me anymore. Besides, now you have these.
What about the boy ox? Am I ever going to see him again? I kind of miss his sweet, terrifying face.
You will see him again. I guarantee it. Thank you.
Okay. The end. Do we have to finish at 7:30, or can we go a little over 7:30?
No, we can.
Kim, you're the boss.
No, you're the boss.
No. All right, sorry. We went until 7:22.
Does everyone want to do questions?
Yeah.
Yes, okay.
I'm here. I'm here until they kick us out.
Okay, cool.
You don't have to go home, but you can't stay here, right? So when you do that, I lose mine?
No.
Check.
No, you shouldn't have lost yours.
Check.
I do.
You talked, the battery's gone.
Yeah?
I don't know.
All right, I might have another battery. Go ahead. Okay. So, you can also probably hear me, right? No? All right. So...
Here, hang on. I'll go get the other one.
Check. That's really awesome that it lasted that long. It lasted until the very last word. How crazy is that? I still can't believe it. Jet, no, it's nothing. All right, we'll do the raffle in the meantime. Oh, all there right, she goes.
Yes, the raffle. Here, you can use this one.
Check. Oh, that's good. All right, I do have a random number generator on my phone, so you don't think that I'm picking favorites. I see people trying to curry favor by saying the one and only after their name. I'm not going to do it that way. All right, because this is for the trilogy, and there will be no more writing books. This is it. Time to move on. The fresh feeling of not having been too well worked, right? Book 4 or 5, somebody just euthanize me if I do that. We have Jerome Kennedy Sr. There you go. Sir, now, did you already buy some?
My son did.
Your son did? Okay. Well, so, you know, whatever you, they might be for, you can outside them later if you like.
Okay.
All right, awesome. That's what happens when you come early. You know, you're in the front row. It's weighted. Okay, questions. Kim's got the microphone there so everybody can hear, so you wait for her. Don't be shy.
I was just wondering, how long is a realistic amount of time to expect to spend on all of these steps? Like you said, like, don't spend your entire life writing a book, but like, how much time should you spend?
That's a good question. So, you know, I should think that a book can be written in a year. So 5 or 6 months on the first draft, plus action steps, 3 months on the second draft, 2 to 3 months on the third draft. It depends how ready it is. Right? So sometimes it's been like brewing for a while, and if you're like ready to go, if you're ready to go, I think a year is good. I mean, I'm a ghostwriter too, so I get people who are like, how fast do we have this book? I'm like, that's not really the question, unless you're paying a lot of money. In which case, I'll say 4 months, but you know, 6 to 9 would be better, because then it gets some nuance. But I think a year is good.
So do your beta reader come from like the target market that you're trying to reach? Like say you're trying to write a story that might affect like urban 15-year-old, 16-year-old kids. Like, should you have that type of person read the book? Or?
It's a great question. So, you know, I do think that people who are in the readership can add a lot. Kids are a unique question, because I don't know, sometimes kids don't always have, you know, the attention span to write you several paragraphs. But you know, you could go to some 15 and 16 year old kids. You could also go to a couple parents.
What about cultural?
Yeah, you could also go to some teachers. I'm just saying, like, to flesh out the 15 to 16 year old. As far as the cultural, I mean, I think people are interested in your genre. So if it's sort of like it's a more urban and grittier, you might get people who like to read that kind of book, but I don't think you have to limit yourself to that. I think sometimes people who just like to read can provide useful things. Also, people who like to read, they may not have read all the same books that you and these other gritty people have read. I don't know if gritty is the thing I'm just saying.
Rough, gritty,
yeah. I don't know. You know, you're talking about urban, and you know, you're talking about, you know, so I extrapolated from there. But you got free books, so settle down. You're not sure, okay? No, just kidding. So anyway, you know, you guys might read some of the same things or see some of the same films, so you might have some conventions in mind, and like you might be taking some shortcuts that they don't notice, whereas some readers who aren't used to that genre might be like, I don't get what happened here, I don't get what happened.
I have a question. If you've written multiple drafts, where do you recommend jumping in on this process to kind of corral everything in?
So I think the question of action steps, I think, you know, anytime a draft is done, you can do the action steps. You can brainstorm your scenes. You can cut your book up. You can find your theme. You can use these tools of the grid, the arc, and the target to reorient yourself. You can do it more than once in a process. Brownie points for clients who do that more than once. You know, and again, you don't have to do every tool, and you don't have to just use mine, you know, whatever works. But I think anytime a draft is done, you have to step away and do some action steps, because otherwise, you don't let the well fill. So you're just jumping right in there, and you're like, I love to write, so today I'm going to try to pump an empty well all day. Like, how fun is that? It's not very fun.
You had mentioned earlier about querying agents, so I didn't know what golden rules you have for that.
Querying agents. Okay, so I think the query letters that I work with have three paragraphs. And the first paragraph is something that hooks them. The second paragraph tells about the book. And the third paragraph tells about the author. So I've heard this as the hook, the book, and the cook, which makes me sick to my stomach. But at the same time, is a convenient way to remember it. So as far as the hook goes, you know, you have to try to grab people's attention. Why is your book just different than the other books that are out there? As far as the book paragraph, that would be a synopsis paragraph. Very difficult to synopsize 80,000 words in a paragraph, but that's your challenge. And then as far as talking about yourself goes, you know, some people have publishing credits, some people have professional achievements, and sometimes you don't really have any of those things, so you have to try to figure out how to spin it. And there's where I usually recommend bringing in comps. You know, like you can talk about it, sort of like Gone with the Wind meets Tron. That would be terrible, but you know what I mean? So that you can do that there, okay? All right? He was a good boy, he deserves books.
Hi.
Hi.
Before you finish a first draft, if you have holes, do you have any recommendations for filling in those holes? You know you need to connect some scenes, but you just...
Yes. I think that anytime you can fill a hole, you should do that. And you should put down the method business and write the first draft of something. Because things always need it. You know, when you write the first draft, it's always a little tenuous, you know, and a little scary. So it's better to just have something on paper. So basically, anytime that you come up with the idea of, like, this needs to be there, I would just bang it out. And then later, figure out where it goes.
Maybe you just answered my question. I was going to ask, do you have any tips for the make the time portion of it? I mean, is it sort of like...
I do.
Working out and, you know, if you work out a lot, you'll want to do it more as opposed to, oh, crap, if you don't do it for 2 weeks, you're going to fall right out that way.
Runner's high, writer's high, like, as a motivator? Sure, why not? I do have tips, though. I think, so, knowing what you're... word production rate is important. So like on a good writing session, I'll write 1,700 words, but I'll take 1,000. You know what I mean? So assuming that 1,000 per session is my baseline, then I'll figure out how many words do I want to write a month. And if it's 10,000, then I'm trying to schedule 10 writing sessions, which isn't that many. That's like 2.5 a week. But I think the key is that, like, let's say that you want to write 3 times a week. I think the thing to do is to schedule it in your calendar. Everybody's got their calendaring tips, right? But I think that you should schedule four. Because then when life gets in the way, which it does, right? It snows, the kids are home. Okay, I'm not writing today. Then you still have three left. So then you know that like life got in the way. Whereas if you miss all four, you know it's actually you got in the way, right? And then you have to have people in your life who can appreciate that you're writing. And you know, writers, we are a very strange breed, and it's, and you know, there aren't people who are necessarily going to get it, right? So you have to just be patient and try to explain, this is really important to me, this is just something I do. I don't know. Now I'm sort of wandering a little bit. I'm just thinking about my wife, who is very supportive, although she's not here tonight because she's already seen it seven times. She was like, is there going to be anything different? I'm like, no, and I'm not going to force something different in it because you're coming, okay? So anyway, enough about the why. Go ahead.
I was wondering, you were talking about I type on the computer and then I do longhand, and I found trying to mesh it all together and then get back to the computer, I'm taking the time to what I did longhand to put into the computer, and then everything's just, I'm losing it all in concentration and focus on it.
Okay, so the question is basically, if you write your first draft longhand...
Well, not even first draft, you have ideas, you're there at the computer, then you do longhand some, another chapter or something.
I think the idea of retyping material as a way of editing is great.
But not while you're trying to the flow of the first draft?
With the first draft, you're just trying to get it out wherever it is. Typing, writing, on the phone, stylus... papyrus, whatever it takes, just blow, it's done. You know, sometimes if I write, or when I wrote the first draft on the typewriter, then I actually had to type it all in, which was great. It was much easier to make decisions. Like, I am not going to write that again. I wrote it once, that's embarrassing, I'm leaving now, you know. So switching the media can help that way. How many more? A couple more?
Where are we at? 1 year.
Okay.
I participated in the Writing November, and it was a great experience. And once it ended, I really felt like I ran out of steam, and I have a little bit written more on it, but I just can't seem to try to get any recommendations or...
So I think, joining a writing group or a critique group, which sometimes can be found online, like meetup groups, or libraries have them, or universities have them. Finding supportive action partners in the writing world is sort of like we were talking previously about working out. It's kind of the same thing, like meeting the buddy at the gym before you get into, you know, hiring people or doing that kind of thing. Getting support, reading to remember how much you love it and how you're trying to contribute to this ongoing conversation of books throughout the generations can be a motivator. Taking some time for yourself to go away for a little while. I don't know what you do or how much time you would have to do that, but like actually going on a retreat for a week or 3 days, now you're in a place where you kind of have to do it. It can be terrifying, but it can also be, once you get over that, you can really settle in and do some great work. I'm actually getting to take a week to go write, which I haven't done since my kids were like 2 and -2. And I imagine the first couple days, first day, it'll be like, oh my God, this is so weird, now I have to produce. But then after that, I'll be like, all right, well, I'm down to 5.5 days, better do stuff.
I've had an idea of, or a thought process in the back of my mind of creating an inventory of characters to then later put into a fictional story. Does that... Do you know people who have done that successfully, or is that a over-organization?
Is that outlining before you ever wrote a word? Not necessarily. I mean, if you're talking about inventory of characters, if you write out the characters and you enjoy the writing of it, and you discover or you see things that are different, yeah, you can develop them, and you can come out with things which are great, you know, you want to keep. Doing that kind of groundwork, I think, like, so J.K. Rowling spent, like, 2 years, getting the rules of her world straight, which is different than outlining every book. I think she only had the outlines for, very rough outlines for the first couple, but she knew the rules. And she did that because, the writing of that, which I think she's since burned or disposed of, because some writers believe they should clean up after themselves. Other writers leave, their mammoth grid at the Brandeis Library. Everybody has to make their choice. But yeah, that so that seemed to really help her.
Hi, I just have a simple question, but you were talking about words per session. Is there some sort of loose grid about, you know, what certain types of novels, how long they should be? I mean, I've heard something thrown out that, you know, a book in general should be like 100,000 words.
It used to be. And then Netflix came around. So it used to be 90,000, 75 to 90,000. Depends on the genre. Right, so readers in certain genres have a certain word count that they are used to. So, like spy thrillers, you can find this online, I think, by googling it. Just word count for genre. The 75 to 90,000 has come down to like 60 to 75,000. Although, you know, I think it's good that our attention span is shorter. It means we're processing faster. I'm about positive. It's not like, oh my God, we were kids, we could read 100,000 words.
Stuart, thank you again.
This guy,
this is great.
Who nodded at all the key moments.
I still didn't win the book, so.
I know. I had no control over that.
No, so I think a lot of people here, you know, that do write probably do a lot of other things in the arts. And I act in a lot of things, and I've actually written a couple of screenplays and things like that. I view dialogue between characters in a book as dialogue that's on stage. Is that the wrong approach for natural? You had mentioned the ear, hearing the ear, and that's how I hear it.
I think that's fantastic. I think that's what most people don't do with dialogue. They don't write lines that people would actually say to each other. They don't put the actors up on stage like those actors up on stage. I would write lines for Biz, and she would just trumple them all up. I mean, she kept 10% of what I said. She kept the gist. But, you know, you have to, it's like things people would actually say, things the way that people actually don't finish their sentences, interrupt each other, don't say what they mean, all that great stuff from theater and film definitely needs to find its way up to the page. And, you know, people who have a dynamic gift for dialogue, that stands out. And certain readers really like that, but everybody appreciates it. I would say that would be great.
Excellent. All right. Great. Thank you, everybody. Thank you so much. Thank you, Stuart.
Thank you.
That was wonderful. So we do have all of Stuart's books downstairs, and I believe he would be happy to sign them for you. So thank you so much for coming.
Yes. You don't have to stay right there.
No, I'm staying here.